Thank you, Ron. I have always loved John the Baptist, and it goes back to 1948. I know the time and almost the exact date. I was John the Baptist in the pageant, the Christmas pageant, at my church, and a very enterprising, marvelous, some kind of a special person had a costume for me. It was a coat, you know, the camel's hair coat, and they had a string that they arranged to be some kind of a belt. But on the front, she had put a patch. It was the picture of a jar of honey, you know, to represent the fact that he ate honey and locusts in the wilderness. And she had on there H-O-N-E-Y. Who knew they could speak English back in the early part of the church, right? And there it was, and then locusts were attached all over my costume. And my one line, prepare the way of the Lord. And I was early on, so this was big time. And how I would do it would determine the rest of the show. That's not quite right, but anyway, I came out in the best of my Shakespearean way I could do it. Prepare ye the way of the Lord. And I said it to little Miriam. Miriam was the daughter of the pastor. I won't mention her name to protect the innocence of that whole family, but poor Miriam was thunderstruck and stage struck and didn't say a word. And there we were. Great silence. Me, all right? Prepare ye the way of the Lord. I mean it. All right, there it was. I got that kind of response from the congregation too, but it was this moment where we all laughed and had a great time, and Miriam came through with a line, and the rest of the pageant, I'm sure, was flawless. But been that many years of remembering and treasuring the spirit of John the Baptist, and so I don't want this day to go by without some referencing to him and the power he has meant to the faith. He was the first cousin of Jesus, a little older than Jesus, and the rest of his ministry, there are 60 references in the scriptures to John the Baptist, so we haven't got time to go through all of that, but one I want to reference today, I think it's so powerful because it's the secret of faith, I believe. It was the secret for him of how he came to understand the Lord, how he came to understand faith, and how he came to understand himself, as we can do the same. What was the secret? All of his disciples came to John because they thought he was the Messiah. They all came and said, "You're the Messiah." What did he say? He, meaning Christ, he must increase, I must decrease. That's the secret. That's the inside knowledge. That's the power you have when we decrease and allow Christ to increase in our lives. And that's been a spiritual principle that has gone on from the beginning of the ministry of John the Baptist. It goes straight through the disciples, straight through Paul. Whenever they tried to what? Get in the way of the Lord because of their own needs, because of their own desires, their own issues, what happened? Chaos, mistakes, sometimes sin even from the disciples. But when they got out of the way, their egos, their selves, and welcomed Christ, what happened? Tremendous amount of goodwill, tremendous amount of love showering over their lives and their families. It was true also later of the great Martin Luther. Martin Luther, who is really our saint in terms of the saint of the church, who did the same thing. What did he do? He kept saying about the power of what? The power of us? No. He talked about the power of grace. Over and over again, how much God loves us. Oh, God loves us so much. And we love each other, yes. But the power of us being able to decrease so that Christ can increase. And what was it he said at this deathbed? What did he write down? What was that? We are all beggars. What does that mean? Nobody answered. What do you mean we're all beggars? We're not beggars. I'm not a beggar. I'm a pastor with an $18 million condo. Come on, I'm here, right? I'm a pastor. I'm not a beggar. Wait. We're all beggars. What did he mean? Because Luther knew a lot more than me. What did he mean by that? He meant that in the end, what? We are nothing, and Christ is what? Everything. Everything. Again, he must increase, I must decrease. And you follow through that, the great St. Francis of Assisi, of course, he always would bow to John the Baptist. It's exactly what St. Francis did with his life. He would decrease his importance, increase the importance of Christ. You know that he gave away all of his goods and everything. I always laugh because people think that the Catholic Church owns St. Francis. Oh, no. He's bigger than the Catholic Church. He's bigger than all religions, really. Everyone, and I know you Lutherans love St. Francis of Assisi because I've gone to your backyards. I've seen statues of him. There he is. He's holding the water for the birds, right? This remarkable St. Francis. And what was his turning point? What was his moment? It was like John's moment. Same thing. The moment certainly had to do with when he gave away everything that he ever had, and he never wanted it back. That was part of it. But the defining moment for him was, he was walking on a road, and there was a leper on the other side. You know the story, many of you. And he had a chance to walk right by. He didn't. He walked over and embraced the leper. He embraced the worst of society, the lowest of society. He embraced the leper. And he felt instead the arms of Christ. This is remarkable. When I decrease Christ and let Christ increase, this sense of warmth, this sense of love, this sense of the experience of Christ is greatly heightened. And in our own modern times, not too far down from here, the great Father Richard Rohr. Some of you know that name, Father Rohr. He has the Center for Contemplation and Action. This remarkable person is a worldwide author. He's wanted everywhere. And we have him in our backyard, this great, great testament to the power of his thoughts, where he brings all this together in many, many ways through his books. And he has a book called Falling Upward. I don't know if you've ever heard of Falling Upward. How can you fall upward? What's that about? Well, he tells it very much the similar of our lives. He said, we're all attaining success. We all want to climb up that ladder, and we all really want this, and we want the perfect families, and we want the perfect everything. And what happens? We stumble and fall. He says somewhere that success means almost nothing after the age of 20, 21. We want our kids to succeed, of course. But after that, success is nothing. Well, what means anything? It's your failures. It's when you fall down. It's when you stumble that you learn from them. It's when you get yourself up with the help of the Lord. That's when your life begins to have focus. He talked about the two halves of life. The before we fall and after. Once we fall, we have that chance then to see ourselves opened up to the power of Christ, the increasing power of Christ. You ask anybody in the 12-step movement, they'll tell you all about it. Letting go and letting God. It's all about, I must what? Decrease, must increase. And more modern day, Carl Jung. Some of you know Carl Jung from the writings. He's now deceased. He was a great psychiatrist. He was in Switzerland, also a theologian. Remarkable way that he pulled faith together with reason, like no one else had done. And he talked about us having shadow selves. And you remember that from your high school, your college readings, shadow selves. What's that? Well, we would put out a kind of fake shadow to everyone else. And inside, we were full of duplicity. Inside, we were full of shame. Often, inside, we were full of darkness. But we would never know out there because we would show the shadow to everyone else. And he talked about the importance of integrating the shadow self into the real self. And this powerful example. And here I pause just to talk about that because I know what it's like. Behind me there's somebody, you don't know my life, you don't know my foibles and whatever, and occasional sins, you don't know, but this is the presence I give you. But I have to laugh because we're all like that. But the great Milton Berle, who was a wonderful comedian, was saying a few words in testimony to Peggy Lee, the great singer, after Peggy Lee died. Some of you remember Peggy Lee. If you don't, here was Peggy Lee. She had this extraordinary voice, and she was a solo singer with a wonderful band. And Peggy Lee, I don't know, for 40, 50 years, had the same hair. How does that work? I don't know how that... Oh, some of you maybe know. Mine changes. I don't get it. But hers never changed. And her face never changed. No wrinkles. That was the same face. How do they do that? It was amazing. Well, she was apparently up in the 25th floor of Caesar's Palace in doing her Vegas act years ago, and she went had to go down, you know, to about the third floor to the makeup room to get ready for her act, and down she goes, and there were a couple of people on the elevator with her, and as she stepped out, somebody said, "Is that you? Are you Peggy Lee?" And she said, "Not yet." "Not yet. I'm not yet the Tom Anderson you think. I'm not yet. But, with the help of Christ, the less of me, the less of you, and the greater is Christ." And all brought to us, I think, by the extraordinary vision of somebody who was true-faced, John the Baptist. May that be your experience as you begin to integrate your two selves, your two lives, into a wholeness and holiness that Christ can bring about. All of this is to honor Christ the Lord. Amen. Amen.